On this Memorial Day Sunday, at the end of this tragic week, tragic 2 weeks, we gather for worship, gather to hold one another with love, gather in remembrance for those lost in all too many wars, gathered in remembrance for all those lost most recently and terribly in Buffalo and Uvalde, including the sweet and beautiful young ones. May our worship this day then offer solace for aching hearts, offer strength for the days to come, offer inspiration that we might better be able to do what needs to be done in our lives in this world. We have gathered. May we be inspired to heal and help one another, our nation and our world. We have gathered in this ancient house of love, and it is good, gathered on this ancient land, sacred to the Massachusetts, Wampanoag, and other Native nations who preceded those from European lands. We have gathered, and it is good. Lighter this morning is Mike Dwyer. Mike.
Thank you, Ken. Good morning, all. To me, in looking ahead for Old Ship Church, two things come to mind. For continuity and context, the brass plaques up on the wall here, reflecting centuries past. Considering purpose, the principles on these UUA bookmarks. The plaques lead us through periods of time that span slavery, the American Revolution, the Civil War, World War, schisms, and that's just the highlights. Somehow this congregation has endured while seeking to be a democratic community making moral and spiritual progress. The principles seem to be sorely needed in this world. An eighth principle is taking shape around diversity and dismantling oppression. To me, the idea of a core set of principles that can grow to meet new challenges means that we can continue to be about things that matter. Looking ahead, if there is an open, active democratic congregation, a home for pursuit of these principles, and a place for ongoing renewal in that future world, I think something important and timeless will have been protected. I light this candle looking ahead for Old Ship Church.
Thank you, Mike. Just beautiful. Good way to begin this morning. Also, beginning this morning, we sing hymn number 1008 in your soft-covered, teal-colored hymn book, When Our Heart is in a Holy Place, 1008.
Thank you.
We do pretty well, even without the choir to lead us. They have the morning off this morning. But thank you all for singing along. Welcome. Good morning. Good morning. On this beautiful summer's, well, late spring, summer-like morning here in Hingham. I hope the weather is good wherever you are on the screen. Some of you not in Hingham. But good to see everybody on the screen or in the building. My name is Reverend Ken Reed Brown. My pronouns are he and him. If you are new, we look forward to getting to know you. And we hope that you'll find ways of getting to know us by exploring our website, oldshipchurch.org, or through conversations with folks following the service here outside on this beautiful day, or online where coffee hour or fellowship hour will continue on the same link right after the service. Again, welcome. My sole announcement this morning of what's coming up, next Sunday is Coming of Age Sunday. I surely hope you all make a point of being present to hear our wonderful coming of age youth help to lead, share the leadership of the service, and share their faith statements. If we ever doubt whether we are doing anything worth doing here at Old Ship, those doubts evaporate when we hear our young people and understand how they have integrated life principles along the lines that Mike was suggesting. So please come. And immediately following the service on the same link will be a repeat of Abby and Mary Diamond Kissaday's presentation, Gender in the 21st Century Overview. So if you missed it, or if you want to catch up again, then plan to attend here in the meeting house and on the link. And finally, we appreciate those who bring food for the local food pantry, and a reminder that you can do that every week in the basket in the vestibule, or during coffee out during office hours during the week across the street. Thank you. Oh, my turn again. So you've been hearing old favorites of mine anyway, I hope some of yours, and these songs for all ages. This one we sang a little bit of a few weeks ago. We haven't sung the whole thing for a little while. It feels to me appropriate just about any time, and certainly in these times. I hope you will join in on the chorus. The words are so complicated. Hoping we'll all pull through. You say that three times, and then you say, me and you. That's the chorus. And at the end of each verse, there are two lines which repeat. Or actually, there are two lines in each verse, and they repeat. So you can sing that repeat along with me. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. Pete Seeger and Laura Wyatt. Oh, it stayed in tune. When we look and we see things that should not be, God's counting on me. God's counting on you. When we look and we see, when we look and we see things that should not be, God's counting on me. God's counting on me. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through, me and you. It's time to turn things around. Trickle up, not trickle down. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. It's time to turn things around. Trickle up, not trickle down. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. Hoping, hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through, me and you. Don't give up, don't give in. Working together we all can win. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. Don't give up, don't give in. Working together we all can win. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through. and you. What we do now, you and me, will affect eternity. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. What we do now, you and me, will affect eternity. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. Here's another verse. There's big problems to be solved. Let's get everyone involved. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. There's big problems to be solved. Let's get everyone involved. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all. Hoping we'll all pull through, me and you. When we sing with younger folks, we can never give up hope. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. When we sing with younger folks, we can never give up hope. God's counting on me. God's counting on you. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through. Hoping we'll all pull through, me and you.
Yeah. Thank you for singing along. We need singing. In that last verse, when we sing with younger folks, we can never give up hope. We must not, particularly with the younger folks, children in mind. We come to our time of candles, lighting candles of joy, sorrow, and concern. If you're on Zoom, you may enter your joy or sorrow, concern into chat, and in a short while, Daveline will read those for us. Several candles to begin with. The first, as we have for months now, for the people of Ukraine and for peace. And the second candle, for the people of Uvalde, Texas, and Buffalo, New York, for solace and healing, and with prayers for real action and change that will make a difference. The third candle this morning comes from Nat Stillman. He asked for a candle for Jim Martin of Linden Pines, where Nat and Tracy also live. Jim dealing with the illness of his wife, Shirley, who's in continuing care at Rose Court there at Linden Pines. And the fourth candle I'll light for Marty Saunders, our dear longtime member Marty, who is also at Rose Court now in the midst of a number of health challenges. So these first four candles. Oh, there was a fifth, actually, given me in advance. And this from Kate Woolley and Maureen Crimmins, a candle of joy. So I told them I can't quite believe that Julie, their daughter, has already graduated from college. And they light this candle of joy. Many of you, most of you, remember, know Julie. Of course, Kate and Maureen, we're pleased to be able to light a candle of joy this morning. Anyone here in the meeting house who has an additional candle? Corey, in the back. Well, a candle of joy for your godson's new child and the confluence of events in this life of joy and sorrow intertwined. Thank you, Corey. Anyone else here in the meeting house? Yes, Eileen. Oh, good to have you here, Judy, Roy's your sister-in-law, Roy's sister. Welcome, welcome. Pat? Oh, I had not heard that. A candle of concern for Joan Bledsoe, also at Rose Court, with an aneurysm. We hold her and Turner in our hearts. Thank you, Pat. And Ralph? Ralph, a candle of sadness for the passing of your friend Ed, unexpectedly, just this Friday. We hold him and you in our hearts. That Jennifer, go ahead. I'm sorry? Yes. When you'd mentioned, so a candle of joy, your neighbor Peter, home with a new heart. We share that joy. Thank you. Daveline, any joys or sorrows on chat?
Yes, Ken, there are several. First of all, from Patience Gardner, a candle of sorrow for the families of the children in Texas. May they feel the love and support of all of us everywhere. Secondly, a candle of concern from Karen Schneider for her return trip this week to the hand specialist to assess if she will need surgery. Jeff and Cindy Neustorfer would like to light a candle of joy for their son Brian's birthday. Ethel Fraga has a candle to end violence. And finally, Ellen Curtin would like to light a candle of joy and happy birthday to Eric's son, Miguel, who turns 21. And those are all the candles of joy and concern in the chat.
These candles burn for all of those. And I will just note that Jeff and Cindy's son, Brian, is our son-in-law. So we just had his birthday. We all celebrate. But we hold all the joys and sorrows in our hearts, just as we hold one another in our hearts. And we know that these candles represent joys, sorrows, or concerns deeply felt among us, even though they've remained unexpressed in words during this time. I don't know that we have any youth, but we will sing them out anyway. And a youth caregiver, go now in peace. The anthem, Christopher.
The world needs.
Bert Bachrach and Hal David often get amens, but I say amen. Thank you, Christopher. And we enter our time of meditation, prayer, and then shared silence. At the end of this week, filled with tragic and disheartening news, we need to restore our souls, nourish our spirits, nourish the love the world needs now, needs always. So we pause to just sit, to be present to one another and to ourselves, to allow our thoughts and feelings to rise and fall with each breath, rising and falling. Just present. And to allow the yearnings of our hearts to rise, prayers. Prayers this day most especially of solace and healing to bereft families in Uvalde. Continued prayers of solace and healing to bereft families in Buffalo. Prayers and resolve to do what we can to support efforts for sensible gun reform and safety. To do what we can, we pray, to support efforts to make our nation safer, the children of our nation safer, people in Black and Brown and Asian communities, trans people, all people safer. Even as we hold in our hearts this day, for our hearts can hold much, hold those in our community who may have sorrow or grief in their hearts, or who may be facing life challenges of whatever sort, holding one another in our hearts as we deepen, ever deepen the bonds of our community of love and friendship. May we feel these bonds of love, community, as we enter a time of renewing silence.
Fitzmarcus will share. Thank you, Corey.
Just tested negative again. Our first reading is Without Hate from the Buddhist tradition. May every creature abound in well-being and peace. May every living being, weak or strong, the long and the small, the short and the medium-sized, the mean, the great, may every living being, seen or unseen, those dwelling far off, those living nearby, those already born, those waiting to be born, may all attain inward peace. Let no one deceive another. Let no one despise another in any situation. Let no one from antipathy or hatred wish evil to anyone at all. Just as a mother with her own life protects her only child from hurt, so within yourself, foster a limitless concern for every living creature. Display a heart of boundless love for all the world in all its height and depth, with broad extent, love unrestrained, without hate or enmity. Then, as you stand or walk, sit or lie, until overcome by drowsiness, devote your mind entirely to this. It is known as living the life divine. Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Corey. Just beautiful. Ancient words brought to life. Our morning offering will be invited. And this morning, as every morning, you here in the meeting house can leave your offering in one of the baskets. There are baskets at each exit. And we do suggest that if you're at all uneasy with steps, we have the beautiful ramp on this side. Your morning offering can be left in those baskets as you leave, or later on today. And for those of you online, we can always make our gifts through the donate link on our website, oldshipchurch.org. And you pull that down, you can make the gift to our Sunday plate offering, which supports all of our ministries, all the ministries of Old Ship. Or you can donate to this month's special outreach offering, which this month, as you know by now, in May, has been for the outright LGBTQ Ukraine Emergency Fund. The morning offering is now invited, and we will appreciate our offertory music, St. Fulbert by C.S. Lang. Thank you, Christopher.
Thank you.
as I neglected to give anyone the opportunity, if you are new or visiting this morning, we did hear about Eileen's sister-in-law, Roy's sister. Any other newcomers or visitors who would like to stand and tell us who you are so that we can offer a warmer welcome to you? Well, it's just us. We're shy visitors. Janet, thank you for the second reading.
Our second reading is We Lift Up Our Hearts in Thanks by Unitarian Universalist Minister, Reverend Richard Fuchs. For the sun and the dawn, which we did not create, for the moon and the evening, which we did not make, for the food which we plant but cannot grow, for friends and loved ones we have not earned and cannot buy, for this gathered company, which welcomes us as we are from wherever we have come, for all our free churches that keep us human and encourage us in our quest for beauty, truth, and love, for all things which come to us as gifts of being from sources beyond ourselves, gifts of life and love and friendship, we lift up our hearts in thanks this day. Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Janet. We're going to invite you to sing again. Our hymn is in your hardback gray hymn book, For the Earth Forever Turning. It is a hymn of praise and gratitude, I think we could say. For the Earth Forever Turning, number 163 in your hymn books. As I begin this sermon titled Looking Ahead, I have in mind the words of a famous yogi, Yogi Berra. His wisdom when he said, as you see printed at the top of your program, it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future. So I'm not going to try to predict the future of Old Ship. Instead, I plan to offer some thoughts that might be of help as we together look ahead at the future here at Old Ship, and look ahead in the context of these, to put it mildly, turbulent and challenging times. including, of course, most recently, tragic beyond imagining, another mass shooting in a school, 19 beautiful children murdered, two wonderful teachers. And as we observe politicians, too many of whom are unwilling to do what must be done to make us all safer, most especially our children. I name this since the future of Old Chip will, of course, be in the context of this and whatever else is going on in the wider world of our communities, nation, and the world. With all this in mind, it seems to me that as a general guide to whatever the future may hold, and this may sound, the reading I'm about to quote may sound in contradiction to my sermon title, but so be it. It seems to me we can do worse than to heed the words of a call to worship that we sometimes use, attributed to Kalidasa, a Hindu poet from many centuries ago. And those words conclude, "Yesterday is but a dream, and tomorrow is only a vision. Tomorrow is only a vision, but today, well lived, makes yesterday a dream of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. Look well, therefore, to this day." So it seems to me that we must, whether as individuals or as a congregation, look well to this day, each day, if we expect tomorrow to have a chance of being a vision of hope, as the reading puts it, hope for the flourishing of our own lives, our families' lives, our life of our congregation, flourishing. And since we do not live in isolation from the wider world, our hopes, these hopes for our personal, congregational flourishing, are nested within our hopes for national flourishing, for the flourishing of all life on the planet, as I often put it. When it comes to our nation, it means the flourishing of our democracy, which means seeking to secure voting rights, reproductive rights, safety of our children and communities from the violence of guns. Further, hopes for our personal, congregational, and national lives are nested in our hopes for the flourishing of all life on the planet, including, of course, in relation to climate justice and for peace. It's a lot. But then we are part of a larger community of Unitarian Universalist congregations which share all these hopes and dreams and actions in that direction, which are part of yet larger, huge communities of faith and otherwise who share these same hopes, who work in these same directions. We are not alone. So all we have to do is what we can do, to use our unique gifts as individuals, as a congregation, to help heal the world one day at a time. Look to this day. And if we do, then the lives of our generation's grandchildren and their children and grandchildren and on will be lived in a more just and peaceful and kinder world. But all this said thus far, when it comes to our congregation, how might we, you, live the life of our Old Chip Church each day, looking to each day, so that we can look ahead with the sort of vision and hopes I've been suggesting thus far? Well, to begin with, it seems we could truly do worse than to take deeply to heart the sentiments in the reading that Corey shared from the Buddhist Metta Sutra, the Sutra on Compassion, as it's called in translation. My own compressed version or condensed version of this sutra is very simple. May all beings be happy. May all beings be well. May all beings be safe and at ease. May all beings be at peace. That's easy to remember and then to repeat and take to heart and then perhaps to name, as I sometimes do in my meditations, particular beings, people to begin with, family, friends, parishioners, who might be, in the words of Christian tradition, standing in the need of prayer. You see, it seems to me if the spirit of such words were to continue to infuse the life of Old Chip, for I think they do already, and to do so ever more deeply, your mutual caring with one another will become ever more, ever deeper, stronger. Time goes on, and your reaching out to serve others will become ever more effective. This is already a congregation, you all know this, of mutual caring, rich mutual caring. But in the midst of busyness and much that needs to be done, particularly for us during this time of many transitions, the spirit of caring will need tending. We'll need tending. So I invite you to keep the vision of a community of care before you as you move forward in the coming months and years, using whatever words work for you to inspire this vision and hope for care of all beings, beginning with this community. If you do, it will make more likely daily acts within a community of mutual care, making the call, sending the email, making a casserole for someone who needs it, or doing all these things just because, to connect, to deepen connections. Further, though this is already a congregation infused with the spirit of caring for the wider world, reaching out to serve others, to help and heal and change in the direction we need change, wouldn't it help to sustain this work of justice and healing, anti-racism, dismantling white supremacy, widening the circle of concern and welcome and so on, climate justice, safety from gun violence and much else? Wouldn't it help to sustain for the long haul, to hold such words, such sentiments in our hearts? The long haul, which is a good thing, as far as I can tell, the beloved community of peace and justice for all is not quite around the corner. Nice if it was, maybe it is, but only if we help to make it so. In any case, we could heed the words of Gandhi, which most of you know, the great souled one, that's what Mahatma means, the great souled one, Gandhi, who said, or at least he is said to have said, be the change you wish to see in the world. But all this sort of thing, and I've been talking really about two of our old ship ministries, nurturing community and serving others. But all this sort of thing begins a step back, doesn't it, with the first of our old ship ministries, nourishing the spirit. My hope and vision for old ship is grounded there in nourishing the spirit. My ministry has been grounded there. Our shared ministry has been grounded there, whether through worship, meditation groups, classes, conversations. You know the kind of conversations I'm talking about, and you've heard me talk about for years, decades, all of which, one way or another, whether in worship, classes, and so on, all of which remind us of who we truly are as human beings, but can so easily forget. Use whatever language you choose. You've heard my words for this many times. Who are we? Individual manifestations of the whole, of cosmos, of the divine, of the interdependent web of life and existence, of love. So my vision and hope for old ship includes your continuing to ground all that you are and all that you do in this recognition and experience of who we are as human beings, not separate egos bouncing against one another. Oh, as I say, the ego, the individual sense of individual self, is necessary for navigating the world, to begin with, just for getting home after church. But that's not the whole of who we are. It's the least part, really. No, not individual egos out to get our little piece of the pie, but beings woven into the fabric of life, fabric and spirit of love. As for things like growing in numbers, attracting new folks, younger families, kids, and so on, becoming more financially secure as a congregation, here I return to lines from a film most of you will recall, Field of Dreams. If you build it, they will come. And he wasn't talking about church. And I'm not talking about a new parish house. Though I'm convinced, I know, you will build a new beautiful and one hopes net zero to boot, new parish house. No, I'm talking about building, if you will, or miraculously continuing to build on the foundation we already have, a congregation that nourishes the spirit of each person who walks through the door of this house or a parish house. I'm talking about a congregation committed to educating mind and heart, the whole person. I'm talking about a congregation filled with mutual care and love and commitment to healing and helping in the wider world, seeking together to bring more peace and justice to our nation and to the world. If you continue to build on this solid, firm foundation that we've been creating together for all these years, really centuries, right? Working closely with and supporting your interim minister, you'll soon know who that is, your interim minister, and then your new settled minister in a couple of years, people will come. And why? Because people know what communities such as ours know they need. People need what communities such as ours offer. More than ever, we human beings need to nourish our spirits, need communities of care, need to feel that we can be of use in our lives, in a world which needs the gifts of each of us. And our Old Ship Church is, and always will be, may it always be, a community that is able to meet these needs, these what really amount to yearnings of the soul of every human being, sometimes buried under those to-do lists and tasks and so on. Finally, for this morning, I want to add a word about the place of gratitude in all this, in the spirit of that beautiful second reading by Dick Fuchs, one of my best friends in the ministry, and you've heard him preach here. Simply put, gratitude, it seems to me, seems pretty clear, is good for the soul and enlivening to the spirit. Gratitude is good for the soul and enlivening to the spirit. It can be all too easy in our lives, including here, to focus only on the problems and challenges, there are plenty of those, to focus on, again, that to-do list, to the neglect of naming and really feeling, taking moments to appreciate with gratitude all that is right with our lives, with our congregation, which is another way of, after all, nourishing the spirit. So when it comes to our Old Ship congregation, however imperfect it has been and is and will be, it's the nature of life and of institutions, however imperfect, it can only be to the good to name with gratitude the gifts that are ours here, have been and will be. Gratitude for all who have come before, so that we too can be here. Gratitude for this beautiful meeting house, home for our spirits. Gratitude for our Unitarian Universalist tradition, our free faith which nourishes us, which guides us, and opens our minds and hearts to wisdom from whatever source. That's this stole that you gave to me 20 years ago, on the occasion of 15 years. Acknowledges that with the symbols from so many of the world's traditions. What a gift to be part of this tradition which accepts wisdom, encourages seeking of wisdom from whatever source, and above all, gratitude for each and every person who walks through these doors, who enters or logs in to these screens, each person with unique gifts to give to our community of love and faith, unique gifts with which to serve one another, to serve others, as we together seek to heal and help in this troubled world in whatever ways we can. Yes, let us be grateful and frequently name our gratitude. It is indeed good for the soul, enlivening for the spirit, helps us to carry on in the midst of, yes, those challenges and difficulties. And then together, in the spirit of all that I've shared this morning, to look to this day, remembering that today well lived makes yesterday a dream of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. Look well, therefore, to this day, even as we look ahead. Look well, therefore, to this day. So may it always be.
we extinguish these flames, representing joys and sorrows and concerns we've heard named. All lit with love and care and concern, which, though the flames are extinguished, we carry in our hearts. And we extinguish this, the flame which represents our free faith. We carry and live that free faith, even as the flame is extinguished. Wherever we go, we carry, and may we always live our free faith. As we engage in building a new way, segue to the hymn by that title, number 1017 in your soft-covered, teal-colored hymn book, 1017, Building a New Way. Such words and such spirit, with gratitude for the blessings of our lives, may we turn this day, this hour, and every day, every hour, turn and make of our lives, with our gifts, a blessing to others, a blessing to life. May it be so. Blessed be, and amen.